guest of honor and speaker is a wonderful privilege for me. I realize this is a difficult one, but the fact that he is a man of tremendous virtue and simplicity excites me to introduce him to everyone here today. After all, he's a living inspiration to each one of us present here. Without any further ado, I would like to invite our distinguished guest on the stage to share his vital input and a request all of you to give him a huge round of applause.
I don't know what to say, really. It's really an honor and a privilege to be here. I never thought the introduction is going to be this big. Let me assure you, it's all a lie. It is. It's genuinely an honor to be here, and it's really the mixed bag of feelings as to what as you know, the introduction said, how the human machinery ticks is really a complex factor of scenarios more than the skill sometimes. And before anything else, let me assure you that I'm not here to give you any specific tips or any specific elements of what you can do or not do to be successful. There is no such algorithm. It's a matter of resilience. It's a matter of how effectively we change and adapt to what's going to be hitting us. But more than that. I would like to share my sets of failures that I have been through. Everything else is really a byproduct. And I would like to understand first, before we begin, as to what is it that you expect today. It's really overwhelming to see a lot of people and a lot of students in person. I've seen that behind the screen and not used to in the last couple of months for sure. But is there anything that you have in mind, that I can at least think of and share with you as you, through a question answer or maybe anything that you have in mind? We'd be more than happy to pick on those topics as well. Anything that you have, any questions that you may have, you want to make that interactive. Please. Yeah.
How you look at the concept of human machinery?
So I think the first part of human machinery is really a blend of how the functional expertise of HR really is not changing into something which is very tech-enabled, right? So I started off a couple of years ago with getting graduated from the HR domain and also law. So while we did that, there was an element of being largely a support function, as typically we are called as, right? So there's a support function to the business. What does that really mean? That we run errands for them, right? We're going to say, here we go there and we do that. They ask us to, okay, get this person in, do this recruitment, get us a paycheck, etc. So that's no longer the case. That doesn't happen anymore. And how does it really work is it's going to change with an element of self-service. So most of these things can be automated. I mean, anything which is highly operational is now been taken over by an algorithm. What you need humans for is to make sure that this marriage effectively happens between a machine and these human requirements that the business has. So typically, this is the change which is happening now from a classic operational model to a highly blended tech-enabled scenario. And this is where the human machinery element typically comes in. We may dwell upon that a little bit more.
My name is Sarit Puri from PGDM 2-year Cardiff program. My question to you is that since the industry is growing and even there's a difference in the employability factor that we are replacing humans with robots. So if in an organization we find there are high performers, but they may not be able to meet the needs of what the robots can do, how does the organization or HRs can essentially look into that matter? Because if you lose those employees, maybe there might be some things that they must be good at. And robots may just go with the coding. So how does the HR department function with that and deal with that?
The current marketplace that exists, right? So both internal and external, is going to be the only, probably one of the most crucial focus areas of HR. Right? It's a very, very soft element of a function. And not just the function, but also in general the business as well. I mean, if you're a manager or a CEO, you're not an HR person, right? But you need to guard that talent and make sure that these guys come. So upskilling, learning, etc. This ecosystem exists, and it's going to continue as well. And the biggest focus is now going to move away, like I said, from the operational side of things, more qualitative and strategic elements of safeguarding the talent, building them, developing them. So this is not going away. On the contrary, tech really enables a little bit more fulfillment. And I think picking on that one, there is an approach that we follow of consumerism, right? So the marketing folks will probably relate that a little bit more, and so would us. We are all consumers of a device, right? You know, you have a cell phone and you have multiple apps on it, and you have those apps based on your personal requirement. You would not have the same number of apps that you do, right? I am on one dating app, you on another app. Not that I am on one, but still. So it's like that you have different requirements to meet your different needs, and therefore you customize your ecosystem accordingly. You choose a different phone. Why? And people are being targeted to different ads. You know, necessarily what you see on when you log in through your browser, you know, history or your phone, you get to see a certain targeted ad. It will be very different for each one of us. You cannot say that if I have seen it, you would have also seen it. No, it's not possible. This is a consumerism approach, because through this approach, marketers and organizations are really selling their products through the internet. And HR now does the same. So we create a customized requirement for employees in an organization. We call it consumerism. So me as a talent, I may have a requirement of, you know, I may have a requirement of doing something in finance, and then somebody else would want to completely leave HR and move into marketing. But I'm just a thought. How can the organization enable that and make that transition happen? This is where you know we've embedded certain techniques and we build a system in which each employee gets a different ecosystem to work on. It's not easy, of course, because this is a highly designed intensive activity, and this also helps us becoming a magnet for external talent. So we try and bring in talent externally. They see our organization as a great place to work for whatever reasons, and simply they can't. So we want to solve that problem as well through this approach.
So what kind of challenges you have faced and how did you overcome it?
I was working with HSBC. I had a great job and I quit. I just walked out of the job. I said, sir, I'm leaving. I want to do photography. Okay, so I left that job and I started doing wildlife photography. I started traveling and stuff. And I had a bit of a success. Please, back on my mind. And I had a bit of a success, and there I would see I have a very low threshold of success. Okay, so for me, if I get one picture published somewhere, you know, I'm happy. I'm happy because something happened. I did not make any money on it, and so I did that. I was very happy with that small 1.5-2 years journey I had, right? And then I started to think about coming back to the corporate world. No big deal. You know, you leave a job, you do travel, and you do wildlife photography. You come back to the corporate world. I could not. You know, so that was, I think, a biggest failure on my side in terms of not researching well enough or not doing my homework well enough before taking the plunge of leaving a job and doing something else. But this also talks about the ecosystem. I think the corporate ecosystem did not support me in coming back. I gave some 14-15 interviews, 15 organizations. I flunked each one of them. That was my biggest failure as I see it. I don't think I was in the best of the mental health at any time when this happened. I thought my corporate life is done. So then I took charge of how I need to do it. So I went on to the next 2-3 interviews that were remaining. And I said that, listen, if you as an organization are okay hiring a male guy who's taken a sabbatical in a country like India, okay, would you be okay with that? So personally, we are fine. No, I need your organization's view, because if I have a personal view and I've had personal views of 15 people, I need your organization's view. If your organization views this thing as a barrier of some kind, right, then I'm sorry, we'll waste each other's time and my mental health takes a bit. So let's not do it. I think that was a change of approach, but I think my biggest failure was acting on impulse when I left that job and I moved on to do photography. Well, looking back, I have no regrets. Looking back, nobody has regrets. about all the things that we've done in the past, work-wise, relationship-wise, or whatever. Nobody has those regrets sometimes, most of the time. But that happened. That I think has been one of my biggest failures, in a way.
How can they kind of stay up to date with understanding what is, understanding what are the changes? And two is, how do they keep on upskilling us? Because upskilling is something that's going to be required throughout your lives. Today, maybe you're doing it, I'm doing it, everybody else is doing it. So, but how does somebody stay relevant to the job and the function that you're doing? Also, the functions are not going to be sticking. So, if I was doing maybe sales earlier, I was doing sales for maybe 20 years.
Right.
Today, people are moving from sales to HR to HR to finance to understanding the entire capital of business. So, what do you want to leave them with in terms of these two aspects?
HR aside, the other functions are typically that are changing. How we try and classify them as the white collar headquarter functions. All HQ functions would eventually be under the radar, which continues to be the case, and they also become a singular unit. So HR finance would become a blended function as one. What remains as the change in finance, for example, is going to be totally taken over by. After a point, you would only need CAs as advisors, but not somebody who would actually do it for you. So the FP&A, planning, budgeting, forecasting, modeling, financial modeling, marketing modeling, research, all of that is being taken over by a set of big data. This is being taken over big data and analytical tools. And we need people to analyze, predict, use them for various decision-making processes, but nothing beyond that. So this function is changing. Now there are two opportunities here on this one. One, you could be on the development side of it, on the forecasting research side of how these functions change, and then what could be the new modeling techniques in the future. So you could look at the research side of finance and maybe marketing, for example. The second part of it is on actually being the analyst side of these functions. So there's one, it's modeling and research, and the other one is on the analyst side of it. So typically roles on these sides are of business analyst, but with a skill of big data. So analytical tools, big data research is something that you need to make sure that you have in your CV. Through your college or through otherwise or through self-learning, and you don't necessarily have to pay money for it. All of this is available for free on the internet. And the best resource to go to initially is LinkedIn Learning. I don't know if you've seen LinkedIn Learning, it's really fantastic. I mean, it's really my go-to place. So that's one place to go. The second piece is where we should also discuss is that we should look at opening up a lab. A small research lab, which is not predominantly for a function, but a lab here with an industry body. With an industry body helping out in creating various use cases, translating into a new problem statement, etc. So that can be a research body here that can help in achieving this objective.
So everybody's asked about HR and blockchain and everything. But there's one question which I need to ask about your college when you were doing your MBA. So how was it and how you dealt with it and how were you focused on doing the double degree? Because here everyone is new, everybody's because somebody's experienced and they really need to be focused.
Honest answer,
or
do you
want to
So I wasn't like focused, okay. I went to this college to, it was the best time of my life. I went to college to, I can be open, right? I went to college with an intent that, don't emulate the same. Okay, so do the other stuff as well. So I went to college to see, okay, now this is a great marketplace for, right? So I'm an active lab, dated stuff. So that's a place where you can think of, having a good time of your life, because that's not going to come back. But by the same time, on a very serious. By the way, my wife is my senior, so from college, and got nothing to do with my college life, right?
It was
so started my career. This happened. But at the same time, I did invest a lot of time in the other degree. But don't take it too hard on yourself. I mean, this college life is meant to be enjoyed, and when you look back, you need to have the non-study memories of it. And that's the point of it. I had a very good time in college. Focused on having a good time. Less of studies. I think it was more experiential. Whatever I had was more through interactions and experience. I in fact got hired in this role. I have to tell you this. I got hired into this project role at Allianz by one of the guys who was my senior in college, and he was with Deloitte son, and he had come for a guest lecture. He came for a guest lecture and I was sitting as part of the group. He left, and little did I know that he would hire me in this role 10 years down the line. And I'm in this role because of this guy. And now I'm still practicing a lecture from Brahma. But that was the case. So, but to answer your question, don't take it too hard, but make sure that this is the time where you make an investment on the learning part of it, where it is more experiential and use case based and not necessarily theoretical. I mean, if it were up to me, I would clearly not study the OBE and the other topics of that theory. I mean, it's good to know, but they don't necessarily come. It's good for conversation, yes. But necessarily, since the experience and the process that matters, these things matter. You're probably not the best person to advise on the technical side of things, but the industry insight matters a lot. Chairman, so heavily viewed with the industry. It's a fantastic setup. The mindset's there. I guess that's it, I guess.
Thanks. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Navo Sharma from the Cardiff 2-year program. And it's an honor to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks for the CX session to Mr. Bostock. On behalf of the entire management group and students of PGM Cardiff Med program, I extend my gratitude to Gauri sir for sharing his graceful words with us today and his experience. We have been fortunate to have an opportunity like you for enriching us in the areas of academics and the industry. And I'm also thankful to all the students and faculty members for coming here and attending the session. This is one of many CXO sessions, and we look forward to have more distinguished profiles in the future to interact with.